Great. Well, thank you so much for having me here. It's really been a pleasure to be in Santa Barbara this week. Really, the highlight has been so far, of course, your beautiful scenery here. What a great campus, but also the amazing students in the Brenn School have been phenomenal. I get to be teaching a class this week with all these students, which has been a lot of fun. So thank you for this opportunity. I didn't really know what to do with this seminar, to be perfectly honest, because I kind of imagine being a university seminar series, you probably get a lot of research talks and this kind of thing, and you know, God knows I went to a lot of these too in my former life. But I thought I would just tell you kind of a story about what it's like to kind of move from working at a university working in a museum. I originally entitled this The Adventures in Science Communication, but maybe it ought to be more about misadventures and miscommunication or something, I don't know. But really what this is really Confessions of a Reformed Academic. So that's really what I'm doing here today, is I managed to escape the ivory tower, but somehow came back, I don't know why. So I want to just kind of start by saying, hey, you know what, I used to work in a place kind of like this, at the University of Wisconsin, then later at the University of Minnesota. In fact, I did time, about 21 years worth of it, in universities on the tenure track and all this kind of stuff, like a lot of you. And I cared about the same things you care about at the Brenn School and other folks who might be watching, really about the global sustainability challenge. You know, how are we going to live in a rapidly changing world? And I always thought of it like not just as a scientist, but really, I always thought about this almost like a historian, saying, you know, for almost all of human existence, and if we go back to early hominids, maybe 6 million years ago, there was one undeniable fact through all of human existence. We were small. Earth was big. Okay? And for, you know, 6 million years of some kind of existence of our ancestors and then us, 300,000 generations, that was entirely true. We could spread out, we could use more resources, we could get more numerous, and it really kind of didn't matter that much at the planetary scale because the Earth was so incredibly vast. But in the last two human generations, that entirely flipped around, and we suddenly became very, very big indeed, and now the Earth looks incredibly small. So why did that happen? Well, we know why that happened. As scientists who work in the environment know this very, very well. But boil it down, it's basically two or three things. One is, well, there are a hell of a lot more of us today than before. We just lived through this explosive growth of human population. We only crossed the first billion mark in the late 18th century, and today we're at about 7.4 billion, most of which happened in the last 50 years. So that's pretty amazing. Secondly, we've become a lot more adept at using energy, resources, and technology to change the world around us. So there are more of us, but we're all a lot more powerful. I love this picture. I love showing it to public audiences and say, you know, this is what the Earth looks like at outer space at night. You don't need a name to show you that's India, and that's Saudi Arabia, and that's Japan, that's South Korea, that's not North Korea right there. Well, that's Kim's house right there. Well, probably shouldn't make fun of a guy with a nuclear bomb, but okay. I hope he's not on Twitter. So there's a lot more of us. We have a lot more power than ever before. And what's really astonishing, I think it's really important for us to step back and think about it. We've lived this, what you know, a lot of scientists would call the Great Acceleration, this incredible period of human history, which we've been alive, has seen more change than all other history combined in many ways. Just in the last 50 years, let's say, we've more than doubled our population. The economy grew about sevenfold if you adjust for purchasing power, inflation, and so on. We use about three times more food, about three times more water, and four times more fossil energy. That's only 50 years. And if you compare that 50-year period not only did more than any other period in history, it did more than all human evolution and human history combined in the lifetime of a single human being. So whether we like it or not, we live in an inflection point in our civilization, in our history, in our species, existence, frankly. And everything is changing. Even the way we change is changing right now. Now, as environmental scientists, we tend to focus on all the negative side of this stuff, right? We're very good at talking about doom and gloom. Okay. Have you noticed we don't get invited to parties very much? Or maybe that's just me. I don't know. Or never more than once, anyway. But so I have to remind myself, maybe you should too, that like, hey, on the whole, actually, a lot of things are getting better. We live in a more literate, safer, long-lived, healthier society than any generations before us. Violence and warfare are way down. More people live in a democracy. More people have basic literacy. Not enough, but we're doing a lot better than any of our previous generations. So that's a good thing. But, and this is kind of the environmental and sustainability challenge, we're doing this by basically propping ourselves up on a degraded planet, We're consuming resources far faster than the planet can regenerate them, and so on. And we see this manifest in so many different ways, whether it's the degradation of land and biodiversity and habitats. This is a rainforest that was burned down to graze a little more cattle. And we go back to the global scale, we can see this incredible footprint of just food. This is work that I used to do before I came to a museum. This is a map with, you know, basically every farm in the world on it, from satellite imagery and census data. All the green areas are areas of the world's crops. The brown areas are the world's pastures. Together, that's about 40% of all the land on Earth is doing one thing, growing food. Interestingly, about 75% of that number is used to grow just meat. The pastures and the croplands devoted to growing animal feed is 75% of that roughly 40%. So meat is the biggest ecosystem on Earth by far, so if you think of it that way, and I do. The other thing we, of course, are manipulating not only is land, but our water resources. Here in California, we know this rather well in the last few years. This is actually a picture taken out of an airplane window flying into Phoenix, looking at iceberg lettuce being grown in the desert. And we know that that water is coming from the Colorado River, which hardly ever flows into the ocean anymore. And we are, again, kind of consuming huge amounts of water resources, mainly for agriculture, but also somewhat for industry, and last for domestic use. And we're collapsing water resources all over the planet, whether it's the Colorado River, the Alajuela Aquifer, Lake Chad, the Aral Sea, and so on and so on and so on. And we're doing that before climate change even really begins to grapple with our hydrologic cycle, which could make things a lot worse. So, of course, we're clearing habitats and land, we're changing the oceans, we're changing our water cycle, and, of course, we're changing the climate system as well. And, you know, this is one that, you know, of course, everyone in this room knows, but it's so bizarre that we have such a hard time convincing the rest of Americans and the rest of the world that this is a real issue. And I'm not sure why that is, but I think I have a hunch that maybe it's because it's the sky. You know, it's really hard for us to physically imagine changing the sky. For thousands of years, we've talked about that's the realm of the gods. You know, this is a place we aspire to go to when we die. So the idea that we humans could somehow change that maybe just runs counter to all the narratives we've been telling ourselves for thousands and thousands of years. I'm not sure. But we just have to remind folks that the sky is not infinite. It's very thin. The lower atmosphere, the troposphere, is about 10 kilometers thick, or about, you know, 6 miles. And that's where all of our water, all of our food, all of our oxygen, and all of our weather comes from. And that's the climate system as well. And we're changing it, and you and I know that. But we got to figure out a way to get other folks to realize we've changed it too. I like to remind people in San Francisco, the thickness of that part of the atmosphere, the troposphere, is less distance than going across San Francisco. So when you're driving across San Francisco, 7 miles by 7 miles, when you drive across San Francisco, it might feel like you're going into outer space sometimes, but you're actually not. And so if we drove straight up, though, you'd notice a really big difference in what we're breathing and what we're experiencing. So the bottom line, I think, of all the science you and I, you know, in this kind of community do in the scientific world, in academia, is showing that we're kind of pushing the planet into its beyond, maybe, limits of what it can do in this current geologic configuration of biodiversity, climate, and oceans and chemistry that we have known for 10,000 years. We're making a new world, one we don't know what it's going to look like, but it's going to have far fewer species than we've known before. It's going to have a very different climate system than we've ever experienced in human civilization. It'll have a different biogeochemistry. It'll have a different ocean. It'll have a different stratosphere. And it'll have different diseases and a totally different coastline than anything we've known in our geologic epoch. So that new world, that Anthropocene, is waiting for us. How different it is still up to us, but it's not going to look like the world that all of our ancestors knew. It's going to be something very, very different. And that's not an environmental problem. It's a civilization problem. Like, you know, do we get to have one? Okay? Like, and these quote, like, what do you think of Western civilization? And kind of said, hey, I think it's a great idea. Well, you know, I think so too. It would be great to have a civilization that could endure, that didn't ruin itself and its planet to feed itself, to get its own water, and to power its civilization. So how we deal with food, how we deal with water, how we deal with energy isn't an environmental issue. It's kind of like, do you get to have an enduring civilization? So that's the real challenge, isn't it? Like, this is the thing we all think about a lot, is how do we power a civilization and run it well, providing for everybody, but also providing for people who've yet to be born, the people who are the future generations who we're basically stealing from. That's also kind of an interesting way to think about this, isn't it? Kind of the ethical dimensions of this. For thousands of generations, we humans have been very good at building a better world for our descendants. We are, I would argue, the first generations who are deliberately and consciously creating a degraded world for our descendants. And we're okay with that, apparently. So there's an ethical dimension to this, too, that we need to think about. So this is no surprise to you. This is the kind of stuff I care about and you've cared about and you all study and work on every single day. And we all know, places like the Bren School and others, that we've got to take a really different approach to this. And we've been calling that approach sustainability. That's a very common word. I hate this word, though. This word sucks. I mean, it's terrible from a branding and communication point of view. It's awful. If I were to ask you, hey, how's your marriage? And you say, it's sustainable. Like, that sucks. Nobody wants, I mean, come on, you know, sustainable? I mean, and think about the etymology of this word. Like, there is no Greek or Roman or Egyptian or Aramaic word that I'm aware of that talks about how to build an enduring civilization that lasts forever and that doesn't degrade its future. We should have had a word for this, but we don't. I think that says something about our civilization. We never had to think about it before, but now we do. So we make up academic-sounding words like sustainability, which is like the worst ever. If you can come up with a better one, please do. Gosh. I'd like to use one like, you know, I don't know, humans and nature thriving today and into tomorrow. But that's too long. So if you come up with a better one, let me know. Does anybody here speak German? There's the German word for sustainability. I can't pronounce this. Mechalkehyde or something? It seems to be derived from... Does somebody know how to pronounce that? No? Oh, okay. Yeah. That what he said. And yeah, exactly. That's what I meant. Something like that. But it's basically the same word the Germans use for pasteurized. And I love that, the idea like, oh, in German you say, I boil it so it doesn't go bad. That's how you say sustainability in German. I'm like, okay. And I don't know what it is in other languages, but like, wow, we can't even talk about this stuff accurately, let alone do it. So, you know, we got a real problem here. But one of the things I do like, what's happening in universities and why I spent so much time on them, is that I really am so excited that especially younger people today are doing great science, but they want science, you know, we do good science, but we want science to do good. And so places like the Bren School and others are doing this magnificent job of, you know, kind of stewarding the careers of young folks who are really trying to do great science in service of the world, not just curiosity-driven science. That's great, and we should always do some of that. But the idea that it's actually applied and solving real problems out in the world. That's what's so wonderful about places like the Bren School and like in Minnesota and other places I've been before too. It's been really, really inspiring. But the thing, to be honest, that I found a little bit frustrating was being kind of in this ivory tower. That, let's face it, universities are not exactly the real world. Sorry, you know, maybe that's news to you, but it's, you know, they're not like the real world. So anyway, I was very happy working in universities, but I found myself more and more spending time with NGOs, more and more with businesses, governments, foundations, and figuring out how you kind of break down those barriers a little bit. I remember when I got hired at the University of Minnesota, the provost who hired me said, your job is to, you know, imagine a building with all the floors of research in this big building with, you know, engineers on one floor and ecologists on another floor and, you know, social scientists on another floor. I want you to build an elevator that connects all those floors together. And I looked at the provost and said, you don't want to hire me. He says, why? He says, I want to get a goddamn chainsaw and open some doors and windows into that building. You need to get outside the building. He looked at me and said, you're hired. That's exactly right. It isn't enough to be interdisciplinary within the university. What helps a lot more is working with the real world, stakeholders and people in business, NGOs, and all of a sudden all those disciplines go away when you focus on real problems. And I think that's what you see in the Bren School. When you focus on a real project, all that kind of academic disciplinary silo stuff doesn't matter because you're working on a real problem. So get out of the ivory tower. And again, the Bren School, you do that really well. But we got to make sure our other academic colleagues do the same thing. So anyway, about 2.5 years ago, I was happily working at the University of Minnesota in a place like the Bren School, very, very happy. And then a really funny thing happened. I got a phone call from a headhunter. And this headhunter said to me, he said, hey, how would you like to run this thing called the California Academy of Sciences? And I said, no, thank you, and hung up. I said, I don't even know what that is. And they said, oh, and it's a museum in Golden Gate Park. I'm like, what? You know, I'd been there in the mid-80s when it was a much older place, and I remember there being laser lights in the planetarium and Pink Floyd music and a lot of really stoned people. So I was like, no thanks, and just hung up. But then a trustee of the academy called me up and said, no, you don't understand. We've built this amazing new facility. It's the greenest building in the world, the first in the world to get a double LEED Platinum building. It's about over $500 million new building. It's an incredible new place, and it is one of the best science museums on the planet, and we'd like you to run it. And I'm like, no, thank you. I don't want to run a museum. That sounds crazy to me. He said, okay, fair enough, but we want to become the world's first sustainability museum, and we don't even want to be a museum. We want to now be an international science education NGO. I'm like, ooh, wait, now that does sound interesting. Now, I don't want this job. I absolutely do not want to run this place at all, but it turns out I'm going to be in San Francisco next week anyway. I'd love to hear what you're doing. Let me pop by and say hello. This is, that sounds great, and we're definitely not going to interview you. This is not, we understand. So I show up to this room, and there's a room full of trustees. I'm like, uh-oh. You know? But we're chatting, and at the end of the chat, I'm offered a job. I'm like, crap, that was an interview, wasn't it? So I fell for that trap, and I said, I don't want this job. I love Minneapolis. I'm definitely not moving to San Francisco. He said, yeah, no problem. Don't worry about it. No problem. But why don't you come back with your family and just visit? No pressure at all. We understand. No problem. But well, here's some airline tickets. Come on out and just have a nice little trip. I'm like, okay. I'm pretty gullible, so you can tell. And I'd never been in the new building before, so on this kind of very low-pressure trip, with absolutely no anticipation I would take this job, I sneak in the building. My family staff have no idea who we are. It's all anonymous, all secret. And so I go and buy some tickets, and I go in with my kids and my wife, and we walk around. And I'm like, wow, this is kind of amazing. And I walk by this, and like, this is the largest indoor coral reef on the planet. And it has messages all about the oceans and sustainability and climate. Like, wow, this is really beautiful. This is kind of amazing. And I walk by this thing, like, wow, this is the world's largest indoor planetarium. Or they're all indoors. It's the world's largest, indoor coral reef. The world's largest planetarium. And they're doing shows about the environment. And they have, like, Pixar engineers working here, making these shows. Like, this is kind of amazing. And I walk by this thing. This is a four-story indoor rainforest. I'm like, oh my God, this is really cool. So about an hour into the visit, something really funny happened. My oldest daughter, who just turned 18, poked me on the shoulder and said, Dad, if you don't take this job, I'm gonna kick your ass. I swear to God, I'm not making this up. And I look at her like, oh, because you like it so much? No, Dad, I've never seen you this happy before. I'm like, what? And I look over at my wife and she's nodding like, you have to take this job. And she was dead set against it an hour before. And like, you have to take this. And I'm like, why? So well, everything you didn't like about universities, that they're elite, they charge too much money, they're not inclusive, they're not open to the public, they're out of touch. You know, museums aren't like this. Look around you. There are thousands and thousands of people all over this place enjoying it. I'm like, wow. So I got hooked. And I said yes to the job right then and there. I should have bought a Camaro. This is like my midlife crisis or something. You know, it would have been a lot easier to just get a car. So I had no idea why I took this job, but something instinctively, I swear to God, it's weird for me to admit this, but it was totally not scientific or rational. I just did it because my daughter told me to. And I really believe that. But I was hooked. And then later, though, now I'll tell you why. So the emotional part of me took this job completely on a whim, which I wondered if I'd regret, and I don't. But what I learned afterward, and this is kind of now the rationalization of why it actually made sense, and this is what I'd love to discuss with you later in the Q&A, is kind of how other institutions besides universities could be your partner, is I learned a few things about museums that are pretty interesting. First of all, museums in America are huge. Huge. Almost 1 billion people will walk into an American museum this year. 1 billion. That's incredible. It's more than all of the sports stadiums and all of the theme parks in the country combined. Until Facebook, this was the largest cultural phenomenon America had ever produced, was an American museum. Now, most of them are art museums, history centers, and so on, but about 1/4 of them are natural history, science, and related kind of scientific organizations. So hundreds of millions of people will spend hours in some institution like this. So we're very, very large. Second is museums are the most trusted institutions left in America. We get about an 85 to 90% approval rating right now, and it's the same for Republicans and Democrats. Name anything that comes close to that right now. Nothing does. Nothing does. Universities get about a 40% approval rating, mostly from Democrats. And you're high. Congress right now, 3%. That's from both parties. The President Obama got 12%. I don't know what Trump will get in terms of highly trusted. We're going to see businesses falling, military falling, church falling, academia still high but falling fast. Cultural institutions, though, like museums and libraries for some reason, and parks are very, very high and are seen as non-governmental and non-commercial and non-partisan and run locally, not by a national interest. So somehow they've stayed out of the culture wars, stayed relevant, and stayed trusted. So they're the biggest cultural phenomenon in the country and the most trusted. You could do some stuff with that. The third is museums are the biggest science teachers in America. It turns out, a lot of people think science Americans are dumb about science. That's not true. That's totally not true. Our kids are, but American adults are not. So if you take a seventh grader and you test them on scientific literacy in middle school or elementary school, we rank at the bottom of OECD countries every damn year, and it's really depressing. So our K-12 system, broken when it comes to science, and well, frankly, everything right now. We gotta do better. But when you take a 35-year-old and ask them across the world, who knows more about science, basic science and vocabulary concepts and so on, Americans actually rank at the top of the OECD countries. We usually tie Japan and South Korea. That's amazing. So what happened between our kids and our adults? Two things. Universities in America are the best in the world. And in American universities, everybody has to take science classes. That's not true in Europe or Asia. So we make up for a lot of our poor K-12 instruction by community colleges, state universities, liberal arts schools, Ivy League, whatever. Americans get a lot of makeup science education in college. Unfortunately, not everybody gets to do that. But a lot of people do. Second is informal science learning is by far the largest mode of science learning in America. Americans learn 70% of what they know about science outside of classrooms. Chief amongst that are museums, but it also includes national parks. It includes Neil deGrasse Tyson on TV. It includes Science Friday. It includes National Geographic. And it even includes silly things like the Big Bang Show or whatever, the Big Bang Theory on TV or whatever. Some of these goofy TV shows. People are kind of, and geek is the new black, right? It's cool to be a geek or a science kid today, especially Bill Gates is a celebrity now, things like that. And people are really into technology, engineering, and some sciences, especially when it relates to technology and medicine. Now, there are two areas where Americans are well below their peers nationally, internationally, on scientific literacy. They're climate change and evolution. That's well known. Not because people are ignorant of this, but those manage to get captured by political discourse in a very negative way. But so surprisingly, Americans know a lot about science, but thankfully 70% of that was done not by colleges or K-12, it was done by the informal science ed parts of America, which are the best in the world. Britain is good too, but the US is really, really good at this. So that's pretty cool. So they're big, they're trusted, and they do more science education than anything in the country by far, which is really pretty amazing. And they do it for everybody, which is really nice. It's extremely democratic. The last thing, though, that I learned from working at the Academy for a long time now is the most important thing about places like museums and aquariums and parks, these kind of non-traditional science teachers, is they teach in a very different way. They don't use the science deficit model. How many of you have heard of that before? Like half of you? Yeah. The science deficit model is what we're all kind of implicitly taught in graduate school, and it's wrong. It's basically that facts are persuasive. No, they're not. Stories are. Beauty is. Awe is. Facts are not persuasive. Just look in Washington right now. And the science deficit model is the idea is if I just tell you the facts on climate change or evolution or whatever again, then suddenly you'll change your mind and come around to my point of view. No, it never works. It's like when Americans are in Europe and you hear them talking, like, if I just speak louder and slower, then you'll understand me, won't you? No, they heard you the first time. They probably understood you the first time. They just don't like you, okay? That's our problem. It's not that people don't like you. That's and me too. You know, nobody likes scientists very much. It isn't about the facts. It's because you haven't gotten through the cultural filter. You haven't figured out how to talk to somebody in a way they want to hear you. And one of the best ways to do that, I found with museums, is we use not just facts. We use the power of awe and wonder and beauty and inspiration. When you walk through that coral reef exhibit, for example, I can take a Donald Trump voter and a Bernie Sanders voter right through that exhibit, and they open up like, oh my God, this is beautiful. They'll see somebody come down like, Brett used to work for us over here. He used to go into the tank and dive in there with a scuba diving mask with a microphone in it and talk about how the oceans are getting warmer and more acidic and corals are dying. And you have Donald Trump voters nodding, eating right out of his hand, going, yes, I believe you. Because you're surrounded by this beautiful scenery, this beautiful fish at awe and wonder, and somehow there's some guy in a scuba suit alive, underwater, talking to me. That person must be really smart. So the message, the scene, and the messenger create a moment that cuts right through all that war and culture stuff. If I started off with a lecture about climate change, dead in the water, half of Americans wouldn't even want to hear you. Do it or surrounded by beautiful fish with a scuba diver and who's talking about an experience that you could relate to, suddenly you have them at hello. And what did you change? Not the facts, you just changed the setting. You included a little awe and wonder, a little bit of beauty, something that everybody connects to. And I've never met once anybody who says, you know, I really hate coral reefs, I think they suck. You know, never. Or, you know, redwoods, we'd be better off without them. Or whales, nah, nuke them all, I don't care. I mean, never met anybody like that, have you? So while we might be divided on politics and about the role of government, the role of science, the role of business in governing ourselves, we're not divided on emotional connections to beauty, awe, wonder, and our children. Those are universal, and in fact, they might even be stronger on sides that you think of as more on the conservative end of the spectrum. Believe it or not, they have those same values, maybe even a little deeper sometimes. So the best way into the human head is in through the human heart, period. And we have to acknowledge that. And if you really want to do science communication well, you have to start with the humanity of science and yourselves. Tell stories, not just facts. Start with beauty and awe and wonder, because those are universal connections. You'll get to everybody that way. But if you just start off with reciting your doctoral thesis to somebody, forget it. Even the people who agree with you are going to zone out of that. So you really have to think differently about science communication. And unfortunately, scientists are, you know, we're not very good at that. So we have a little bit of work to do. Okay, well, let me tell you a little bit about this place, since, you know, shameless plug for maybe partnerships for some of you. Some, you know, maybe tell you a little bit about what we're up to. I'll tell you a bit about this journey from going from scientist to science communicator and, you know, what I've learned a little bit along the way. But let me tell you about this kind of funny place I run in case you ever want to go there or maybe find us as a potential partner. This is the roof of the building, believe it or not. Looks kind of like the Teletubbies or something, or I don't know, or, you know, Logan's Run meets The Hobbit or something, I don't know. But anyway, the Cal Academy is a very interesting place. We have a lot of cool things. I mentioned a few of them. We're the only museum in the world that's an aquarium and a planetarium and a natural history museum all in one. In Chicago, you'd have to go to the Shed, the Field, and the Adler in separate buildings, even just to catch up to what we do, which is pretty cool. What we want to be is the first sustainability museum in the world, and we're moving there very quickly. And we're moving from being a place-based museum you have to go to now a global science education NGO, and we're doing that too. Our new mission statement's really simple. It's to explore, explain, and sustain life on Earth. So life is the unit of measure for us. Everything is about the living world. We have 40,000 live animals in our building, by the way, not including the humans. And that's a lot of fun. We've launched 6 new missions, which are kind of interesting. Some of you work on these things too, so I thought I'd mention them in case there's some opportunities for collaboration. You guys do a lot of great science. We tell a lot of great stories. Maybe we can hook up. We work in 3 regions of the world as special initiatives and 3 kind of new ways we're working. One initiative is really exciting is around coral reefs. So I mentioned this before. This is the largest indoor coral reef in the planet. We grew the corals in aquariums at the Cal Academy, the only place on Earth that can do that. It's about a $100 million coral laboratory in this place, which no university in the world can match. It's really cool. But along the way, we've learned a lot about corals. Now, one thing that's kind of cool about coral reefs, I'm not a marine biologist, some of you are, but I learned that coral reefs cover about 0.1% of the ocean, but they hold about 1/4 of all the ocean's biodiversity. They're the basis of a lot of the food chains of the oceans, the fisheries of the oceans. They also protect our shorelines. They produce billions of dollars of economic services to the world, also with tourism, even drugs like AZT, an antiviral drug. I didn't know this, but that was synthesized from Caribbean corals at one point. So coral reefs are bloody important. If we don't have healthy corals, we're not going to have a healthy planet or healthy oceans. But the problem is corals are changing. We know from climate change, from overfishing, from bleaching, from ocean acidification. They're getting hammered from every possible direction. And we're looking at how they're dying all over the world. You'll see it again and again and again, like the Great Barrier Reef had a big bleaching episode and so on. Hugely, hugely important. But one of the problems is we've been looking in the wrong places. It turns out 99% of the coral science done in the world is done by people in scuba gear, because that's what you can afford on your NSF grants. You can get on a scuba equipment, and you can go down about 100 feet in scuba gear, and you get to turn around and go back up again. But you know what? Corals don't have to wear scuba gear. They live down as deep as 500 and 600 feet. So if you think about it, three-dimensionally, about 80% of the world's coral reefs have never been seen by like anybody, practically. So that's crazy. 80% of the coral reefs have hardly been seen, let alone monitored, to see how are they faring under climate change, overfishing, ocean acidification, and so on. So we've launched this big initiative to explore that region between 100 feet and 600 feet. We call it the twilight zone, or the mesophotic region, the middle light region. It turns out you can explore that region, but you've got to be very, very, very careful and very specially trained to do it. What we do is we use something called a closed circuit rebreather. It's like an underwater spacesuit. These were invented by the military. What you're doing is you're breathing pure helium and oxygen, basically, mixture, and then you exhale helium and CO2. It scrubs out the CO2 and replenishes the oxygen. It's more complicated than a spacesuit in orbit because you can't breathe nitrogen at these depths. You're breathing helium. And it's very complicated, very, very dangerous equipment. There used to be about 16 scientists who did this around the world. Two died last year, not from our team, but this is actually pretty dangerous stuff. Of the remaining people who do this, half of them work for me right now. We've went around the world stealing crazy marine biologists, basically. And like six or seven of these folks, now, depending, work either full or part-time at the Cal Academy now, which is pretty, pretty cool. And so we've been mounting, we've launched a five-year project for 20 expeditions to these deeper reefs to ask what's going on down there. Are there new things to be found, or are other species that are dying at the surface moving down into the colder water, trading off energy from the sun for colder habitats? Are these refugia for coral reefs facing global threats from climate change, for example? But along the way, we discover amazing new creatures. These are just some photos of new species we've discovered down in these depths. These are some crazy new fish, all sorts of interesting new invertebrates we discovered down there. I love this weird sea cucumber. That's a new species of sea cucumber. All sorts of weird invertebrates. And we managed to bring back most of these things alive from that depth into the Cal Academy. We're the only place in the world you can see these animals alive, because one of our engineers invented a fish decompression chamber, believe it or not. And he made it for about $100 from stuff you can get at Home Depot, which I love. Unfortunately, the Monterey Bay Aquarium just stole him, which kind of pisses me off. But anyway, really smart guy. But we still have the chambers, which is cool. So we managed to bring back a lot of these things alive to the Academy and show them to the public, which is really, really cool. So we're discovering hundreds of new species, but also, more importantly, looking at, you know, are there things that are diving down deeper? And what's the relationship between those organisms down below and the ones at the surface? And we're running a whole bunch of genomic stuff on them, but also their food and what's in their guts to understand how coupled are the surface reefs to the subsurface reefs. We're going to rewrite the whole book in coral biology in the next 5 years, and happening in a museum. So all the science is always shared with the public, which is really, really cool. The other thing we're doing is we're changing the way corals are being restored. When a coral reef dies, a lot of people say, hey, let's restore it. You can do this. but it's really slow and expensive. What you usually do is you go by a nearby reef that's still alive, break off a little piece of coral that's alive, swim back to a lab, like at the Cal Academy or someplace in Miami or something, put it under lights and grow it in a big chamber like this. And you can grow them up in these huge tanks. We have lots of these things. You can grow them up a little bit and then go back into the ocean and literally super glue it onto a dead reef with a scuba diver and hope that it takes. It's kind of like grafting a tree onto another kind of tree. That's very slow, very expensive, and you're cloning the same organism again and again and again. So it's kind of brittle. If that organism dies, pretty much all of them are going to die. What we do is actually say, no, we're not doing that. We're waiting. Corals, remember, are animals, and they reproduce sexually as well. So what we do is we wait until coral reefs spawn. And when they spawn, it's magnificent. The entire reef spawns at once, a couple of times a year, under the full moon at night, which is really weird, kind of romantic, but strange. I think they're playing Barry White music in the background. I don't know what they're doing. But something kind of cool happened. The whole reef just spawns together. And we go around and swim around and collect millions of little fertilized coral eggs, basically. Just like in vitro fertilization, in nature, only about 1% of those eggs will survive and become adult corals. We just get the other 99%. We swim back and put them in labs like this and let them settle out onto little pieces of ceramic or concrete by the thousands. We call these seed bombs, and we're making them by the thousands and thousands and thousands. And you can just throw them over the side of a boat, and they'll attach to a reef and have tens of thousands of new little individuals that could take off depending on the environmental conditions. And we're actually trying to figure out how to deliver them by drone and dirigibles over vast areas. We're not making that up. We got a whole bunch of Silicon Valley people working on that right now. And we're launching the world's largest coral restoration project jointly with TNC and an outfit called SeaCore in the Caribbean right now, restoring 2 million new reefs with at 1/1000th the cost of doing it the previous technology. So we've dropped the cost by a factor of 1,000, scaled it up by 2 orders of magnitude, and we're trying to get the cost down another 2 orders of magnitude in the next 5 years. And then we're giving away the technology to CI, TNC, and anybody else who'll take it. So that's pretty cool. So we're reinventing coral biology, trying to scale up the technology stuff. The other thing, as a public science institution, we do is we have the largest exhibit for coral reefs in the world. This is a kind of, we remodeled it completely. It's very exciting, has a whole bunch of these new Twilight Zone animals in it. There's a whole bunch of new sustainability messages in it, and it's seen by about 1 million people a year. So over the next 5 years, 5 million people will personally experience this exhibit, and it's really pretty cool. But we're also building the world's first planetarium show about coral reefs. We're using a full 360 dome experience and submersing it in digital water. So you feel like you're completely underwater in this huge spherical environment. You can also adapt it to VR goggles, same spherical coordinates, doesn't matter. And we're going to give away that show to every planetarium in the world, every VR distributor in the world, and also make a flat screen edition. So we can see 5 million people on our exhibit. This could be seen by 200 million people over the next 5 years. We're doing that too. So we're hoping to really move the needle on coral biology, coral restoration, and coral outreach and education in a way nobody else has ever done before. So that's pretty cool. That's a coral initiative. We're going to do something very similar on tropical rainforests starting next year. And this year, we're launching a big California Coast Initiative, looking at how global change is affecting offshore things like whales and inshore things like redwoods in this beautiful part of the world that we know and love here in California. We chose whales and redwoods to be the storytellers of climate change because they're the two most iconic things Californians love about this part of the world. By the way, we used to have a climate change exhibit. We're never doing that again. Never, ever, ever, at least while I'm working there, we'll never do an exhibit on evolution or climate change. And we're in San Francisco. It's not that people deny those things. It's just, imagine you're there with your five-year-old. Oh, there's an exhibit about climate change. Oh, look, penguins. Yeah, I'm going to go to the penguins every damn time. Or, oh, an exhibit about evolution. That sounds nice. Or, look, oh, hey, I can go to the planetarium show about space. You're going to go there. So what we do is we're going to make an exhibit that's really a climate change exhibit, but we're going to call it the Giants of Land and Sea. And we're going to use redwoods and whales. That's what the exhibit looks like it's about. What it's really about is climate change in California, using those as the storytellers. Facts aren't good. Stories are better. You can embed the facts all you want, but if you don't have a hero to the narrative, it isn't going to work. Nobody will go. So that's something we're working on a lot. Okay, last thing I want to mention, and we'll wrap up and have some Q&A here. We're also trying to figure out how to change as an organization, because museums until recently have been very place-based. You had to go there in order to experience it at all. We need to change that, because we can only reach so many people. We can reach maybe about 2 million people a year at the Cal Academy, which is great, and we want to keep doing that. But now we want to reach bigger and bigger audiences. How will we do that? Well, first, we're going to double down in our backyard to make sure that everybody who wants to come can come. So in San Francisco, we face a lot of pressures on income inequality, on cost of living going out of into the stratosphere. It's the most expensive city in the country now. It's more expensive than New York now to live there, which is crazy. But we've launched this thing called the Academy for All that is a promise to every child in the Bay Area. So you get to come to the Cal Academy. I don't care what your background is, what your economics are, we're going to get you here. If the price of a ticket is a barrier, we'll waive it. More often, it's you can't get here because you couldn't get to our front doors because we're not on the BART. You aren't either. So we'll get a bus and we'll send it to you and come pick you up. In fact, Google hired a whole bunch of buses and we got every fifth grader from Oakland to the Cal Academy for free, courtesy of Google last year. That was pretty cool. We're going to guilt them into doing more next year. I think we're going to go after Uber now. I think they're feeling a little guilty. And there's a little bit of guilt going around in Silicon Valley these days. I know how to manipulate that. I think we're going to use it. You know? Coming after you, Uber. No. But we can, you know, have these companies do some good in the world. Like, hey, let's go get all the kids and bring them. You know, imagine Uber driving Ubers to go get kids. That would be awesome. Anyway, that's a good idea. I should think about it, actually. It just occurred to me. Anyway, so Academy for All, we're trying to make a promise to every kid in the Bay Area. But what we've done this last year is also we made a promise to every teacher in America, all 50 states, saying we've got your backs too. We have become the largest distributor of environmental science media kits in the country in 1 year by taking like our visualization products and aligning them with teaching standards for every state in the country. So we create 50 different versions of everything for middle school and high school science teachers who want to do something related to the environment. So they're really beautiful, standards aligned, and they speak to kids because we use kids as the narrators of these shows, not middle-aged white guys like me, but kids who look like American kids from all backgrounds. Really powerful, and we had 120 million classroom views this year, this last year. We had zero the year before. So that's been a really big partnership. The last thing we did is we created a new media arm called Biographic, and I'm inviting anybody here who wants to pitch a story or an op-ed to us to do so. Biographic, if you go to biographic.com, it's I would argue the world's most beautiful web magazine. It is gorgeous. And it's a stunning presentation with parallaxing photo and video and text. You'll never see anything quite like it. We partnered with a company in San Francisco called Storied, which is reinventing content management on the web. It's absolutely stunning. But the clever thing we did is we approached The Guardian, newspapers in the UK, Atlantic Monthly, Fast Company, Wired, Gizmodo, Scientific American, and about a dozen other magazines said, we're going to give you everything we publish for free. You can reprint it and call it yours, put your logo on it. You can even charge for it. I don't care. We just want you to distribute it. So between 12 other magazines and us, we now collectively reach about 80 million digital eyeballs a month. That's more than National Geographic can reach. And we're doing it for far less money, because we're just giving away content. This has been amazing, and basically all of the stories are about the beauty and awe and wonder of nature and the heroes who work to sustain it. So if you have ideas, and we'd love to get much more science voices in here as op-eds, and we have good editors, so don't worry, and we can get it into good language. But anyway, so that's a bit of a pitch for all of you if you're interested. Well, let me just wrap up is that, again, a lot of you, I suspect, in this room are scientists or people who care a lot about environmental science who are working right now in an academic setting. There are other choices for you out there. And a lot of Bren School students will go off and work in NGOs and governments and companies and all over the world, which is fantastic. But you know, don't forget the cultural institutions, because they might be important too. And museums, I stumbled across totally by accident, turn out to be maybe one of the most powerful allies we have in communicating the sustainability issues. Finally, I just wanted to remind you again about the power of like emotion to connect people to science. As scientists, we tend to always want to discount that. And we often have, like in a quadrant, we might have on one axis problems and solutions, and another axis fear and hope. Far too often, we focus on the problems and the fearful messaging. We need to kind of translate up here to solutions and hope, because that's what activates people. This does not. This is turning people off and it isn't working. So one of the things I like to remind people about is you're not alone, not only in your time, but in the future. When I used to teach freshmen, I used to say, you know, we need to work with future generations and to solve our sustainability challenge. But this is like an 18-year-old. And they look at me like, what are you talking about? I don't have kids yet. I can't relate to that yet. So I'd show them these pictures. Said, you're working with people from Sydney and Santiago and Amsterdam and Rio and Hong Kong. And you know what happened every time I'd show this to a freshman class? They had all like, hey, he's kind of cute. Is he on Tinder? You know, or is she on Facebook? I'd like to really get to know her. And I'd laugh, say, well, actually, none of these people exist. This is an art project called The Face of Tomorrow, where a guy with a digital camera went around all these cities and just photographed hundreds of ordinary people on the street and then digitally superimposed all the images and pulled out, probably with eigenvectors and stuff, whatever, but pulled the emergent face out of the crowd. And so the idea is this is who we are in the future. Apparently in the future, we're all going to be ridiculously good looking or something, just kind of cool. But for some reason, that gives people hope to think of the future. And I guess at the end, even though we're a bunch of scientists, maybe the most powerful thing we can do is to articulate a vision with hope in it once in a while, because we need to. If we don't, who will? And even though it's not a scientist, this is what I'm going to leave you with. This is probably the best thing I've ever read about sustainability, and it wasn't about sustainability. Barbara Kingsolver wrote in a book called Animal Dreams, it's actually about a human rights issue. She wrote once this little passage I'll just read to you. She said, here's what I've decided. The very least you can do in your life is figure out what you hope for. What I want is so simple I almost can't say it. Elementary kindness. Enough to eat. Enough to go around. And the possibility that kids might one day grow up to be neither the destroyers nor the destroyed. And that's about it. So with that, let me stop, and I think we have about 10 minutes for questions or so. So thanks, and see if we have some time for...
Thank you, Jim, for a very inspiring talk. I just learned that next time whenever I want to convince someone, I should wear wetsuits and scuba gears.
Well, it depends on the setting. They might call the police. You're wearing a big dark mask and... fins might hopefully you're underwater, but yeah.
All right. So we have a few minutes for question and answers. Anyone would start?
Love to hear some students in here too. Yeah.
Yeah, I can probably So over there.
This one up here. Yeah, it's this woman in the maroon there. Yeah, here you go. Yeah.
Hi, I am a PhD student here, and I was wondering. Uh-huh. If you could talk about how you are trying to make materials you distribute online and to people who aren't going to come through the museum relevant. There's been this widespread push more broadly for online education, which has broadly been a huge failure, because it turns out most people don't really enjoy watching videos of people giving lectures and internalizing more traditional media, which is the easiest way to communicate whatever you do without someone being physically there. So how do you hope to accomplish that more effectively?
Yeah. Well, I think I answered your own question in a way. Yes, you're right. It turns out that I would say online education is a spectacular success. Universities have been a spectacular failure at doing it. It's been everybody else has been successful, universities, because what we've done is we've just simply translated boring white guy lecturing for 3 hours a week for 45 hours of lectures and call it a MOOC. Are you out of your mind? Have you ever seen how people consume media? That will never, ever, ever, ever work. And that's what's been a huge failure. Translating the lecture format to online, well, the lecture format probably should just die, even though I just gave a lecture, right? That needs to go away pretty fast. But Khan Academy, for example, 3 to 5 minute chunks, organized in a nonlinear fashion, you can just consume it any way. He has 1 billion students, billion, for free. I think that's a spectacular success. Or TED, don't speak for more than 18 minutes. Billions of people have downloaded TED Talks. Or podcast, or you name it. What we found is the most consumable unit, the popcorn, I call it, of the internet, where you just go num, 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 you just keep on picking up little pieces and keep eating it, and before you know it, you've eaten a whole bag of it, is 2 to 3 minute videos of people who are like you. So when we want to get to middle school kids, guess who's on the video? Middle school kids. not people like me. And we don't go on for 50 minutes. And we do it in a very non-linear way. Like, I consume media linearly. Like, I like to read chapter one, then chapter two. People who are under 30 don't do that, apparently. They like to just hop around, and it kind of looks to me like chaos, but it seems to work for them. I don't know. So we have to know how people consume media and adapt to that, but you can't take a university course and just stick it online and expect anybody to watch it. They just fall off immediately. Like, duh, of course they are. But that doesn't mean that's the only way to do it. So there's a huge bifurcation of online education, those that work and those that are just obviously not. But I think this stuff is actually pretty amazing. There's some hugely successful stuff. So we've been partnering with Khan, PBS, iTunes, Apple, iTunes University has been hugely successful. And doing everything for free, which is really, I mean, if I were, I would not want to be starting a university today. Let's put it that way. The economic foundations of higher education are really screwed up. I'm kind of glad to be out of it, to be honest, because I don't think they're going to last the next decade or two the way we configure them now. There's no way you can deliver that content at this price point and get away with it for very long. So, sorry, but universities are in huge trouble in the next 10 to 20 years. I think it's time for a massive disruption in this, but I don't know what it's going to be. But it's certainly not what we do today. Yeah. Who's next? Somebody. Go ahead. Hi.
Thanks very much for that. That was, yeah, super interesting. I was really interested in your hatred of sustainability as a branding. I was wondering how you see yourself, or how you see the Cal Academy rolling out as the biggest sustainability NGO in the world.
But then,
if you have the label of sustainability, then you're going to turn a lot of people off quickly. So I guess the balance between the fact that nobody wants to hear about this stuff because it's depressing and preachy, with the fact that you need to tell everyone about this stuff.
Yeah, that's a real struggle. I don't know the answer to that yet. That's what we have found is that, like, again, if you go to that quadrant space I'm talking about, like, if I see one more bloody video of ice sheets falling into the ocean, I'm going to scream. I mean, like, and we've had two huge documentaries come out this year about climate change, just before the flood with Leonardo DiCaprio. I love DiCaprio. I love their organization. They're friends. But it was super depressing. I mean, it starts with Hieronymus Bosch painting, for Christ's sake. Have you seen this movie? It was over his crib when he was a baby. What kind of sick parent does that? Oh, my God. Anyway, but then it was Years of Living Dangerously, great, but also, like, doom and gloom. It was disaster porn, is what we call it. It's like more and more, I mean, we don't need more of that. We need more hope and awe and wonder and solutions. So get out there and talk about that. But the word sustainability has become kind of loaded and kind of wasn't very good to begin with. I think we want to use words like thrive, or, focus on the co-benefits. And again, don't call it an environmental issue. It's like, this is about your health. This is about the economy. This is about jobs. This is about competitiveness. This is about, you know, like, making your town better. Nobody's against that stuff. So I think that's where we kind of need to rethink the framing of these things. But I know, to begin with, what I've learned anyway is more solutions, more awe and wonder, more hopeful messaging. Not Pollyanna, you know, don't be like, oh, it's all going to be fine. I just eat tofu and it's all good. You know, no, it's hard. Sustainability is hard, but it's possible. Also, to show possible. You know that Gandhi quote, anything that exists is possible. Let's talk about what does exist. There are all sorts of solutions to climate change out there happening right now. Why aren't we talking about them more? I'd like to see 10 times more coverage of that kind of stuff, of like what we're doing with batteries, what we're doing, why PV panels are falling faster than Moore's law, why LED lighting is getting cheaper by the minute. You know, there's all sorts of great things happening in the world, but we see more pictures of icebergs. I don't know. I think we need to tell the story differently. And we, especially environmental scientists, we seem to get more points for how scary our work is or something. I think we need to work a little, and I think the Brent School is a little different, but I think we need to look for solutions and a little more hopeful stuff where we can find it, but not ignore the difficult messages, but let's balance it with things to get people. You know, to get on the soapbox, if you look at polls for the last couple of months, and I study these a lot right now, Americans have never been more hopeless feeling ever in our history, even during the Depression and World War II. We've been tracking this for a long time. More than half of Americans have a very negative view about the future of this country today. That's never been true before, ever. Even in the Civil War, I doubt it was true. So it's kind of astonishing. And you know what? And we never felt more divided. This is the most funny statistic I've heard all month. Did you know that the vast majority of Americans, over 85% of Americans, the huge majority of Americans, are unified collectively together in our belief that we've never been more divided? What the hell? That's a true statistic. I'm not making that up. So is something weird going on? And the more we give negative messages and kind of in polarizing language, the more people are, there's actually a neurological effect. You see a physiological reaction to people watching these things. You can see, you know, serotonin levels change, people's blood pressure changes, and they literally physiologically shut down. We can't handle any more. So we got to change the tone. This is a real like neuroscience thing people are seeing. Also, did you know 1/3 of Americans now are saying they have physiological effects of stress in their lives today? 1/3 of us. Holy, you know, I mean, what is going on? So if we're feeding into that, making people feel worse, I don't think it's helping our cause. So I'm sorry to get on that soapbox, but I think the messaging of the environmental movement is precisely the wrong way to go right now. We can't scare people anymore. We can't take it. Yeah?
Follow up the sustainability question, turning it back to the Cal Academy. My name is Mark. I'm a postdoc working between Nature Conservancy and UCSB.
Cool.
And
are you so a Smith Fellow or something, or one of the?
NatureNet.
Oh, yeah, cool. Yeah, yeah. Okay, yeah, yeah, right.
But the mission statement you had said for a lot of these programs at Cal Academy is explore, explain, and sustain. And in the three missions, coral reefs, tropical rainforests, and California coast, I heard a lot of cool explore and explain. Can you speak to, I guess, for first the other three missions, just like naming them briefly, and then what are some of the plans that you have at Cal Academy to get into the sustain as part of the exhibits, online content, everything broadly?
Yeah. That's a really great question. The sustain part is really the kind of the hard one. What we're trying to do, and we're not like a bunch of environmental lawyers who are going to like, you know, sue the EPA. We're not 350.org. We're not going to chain ourselves to the White House fence or whatever. You know, it's not what we do. We're educators, storytellers, and scientists. So our goal would be to, you know, how do we use scientific discovery to inform sustainability? So this work we're doing in coral reefs, for example, saying, oh, if 80% of the reefs are not even being looked at, maybe we need to do that in order to inform like marine protected areas. Believe it or not, no marine protected area in the world is looking at the mesophotic part of their reef. Whoops, 80% of the reef you just ignored. Maybe we could fix that. Or if there are climate refuge areas where species can go down deeper, maybe that informs new policy or new ways we think about conservation. So it's kind of science to inform sustainability practice better. Similarly with education. But in this case, we actually have some technical know-how too about, hey, we invented some technology on how to restore reefs 1,000 times cheaper than anybody had ever done it before and can take it to scale far better than anybody can do it before, and we're going to give it away. So in particular, we've given it away to the Nature Conservancy's Caribbean program, and they're taking it out to scale right now. We're not waiting to publish it. In fact, we actually tell our scientists, don't bother publishing stuff. Go out and do it. We tell our scientists, like our tenure track scientists, actually get discouraged from doing peer review articles because, like, why? It's a waste of time. Go work with an NGO. Go do an op-ed in the New York Times. That's how you get promoted faster at the Cal Academy than a university, because why wait 3 years to publish something in an obscure article? And, oh, wow, you know, that journal has an impact factor of 5. Do you realize what that means? It means 5 people cited it. Kim Kardashian can do that in a second. You know, I mean, like, you know, like, are you kidding me? You know, like, this is not impact. So I think we're trying to get science to have impact, which we're going to do a lot more partnerships with NGOs, governments, and businesses, and not worry too much about the publishing stuff. We'll do that as we need to, but it's trying to do that. So that's kind of how we're approaching sustainability, is what education and science needs to be done to inform sustainability practice and do that kind of science, not the academic kind of science that is mainly for academic science sake, which we need to do too, don't get me wrong, but we need a somewhat different flavor of it to get out there. I wish I knew the complete answer to that question, but that's kind of as far as we've taken it so far.
Well, I think that is probably the last question that we have time for. Thank you again. Please join me to thank John.
Great, thank you. Thanks for having me here today. Thanks.